Hi everyone, welcome back to the second episode in this webinar series on BIM management. I'm Damien, I'm here with Ezzy.
Hello, hi everyone.
So today we're going to be talking about BIM execution planning, so take it away Ezzy.
We're going to start with why do we need a BIM execution plan, or BEP for short, and what to include in your BEP, how to engage your team, and how to get agreement, and how do we take the successful parts of one project and transfer them over to the next project and make sure that everything works nicely.
So the first thing we're going to discuss is why. Why do we need a BIM execution plan? So not planning can cause a lot of confusions, like you see here. You know, you get a lot of blame and finger pointing. And that can happen with any task. But when you take in something as complex as a BIM project, where you have multiple teams working together, that risk becomes a lot greater.
Sure. And as we can see here, these statistics are from PMI. And the three main reasons why projects fail: first of all, poor communication, and then insufficient resource planning, and thirdly, unrealistic schedules. These are all related to things that we can plan for. So if we can have a plan for these from the start, we have the opportunity to solve these issues before they become a serious issue.
So we looked at project maturity levels, and what we found is that to start with these ad hoc processes with no formal standards, where reporting is sporadic, there's a lot of confusion, there's a lot of blame. And what we've done is we've linked these to the lean philosophy of plan, do, check, and act. The second level is the plans level, which is when there's the beginnings of some type of operational standard, but it's inconsistently managed.
And the third level is where you've got a plan and you're actually doing it, and you're in the manage level. The organizational standards are in place and maybe they're not being followed so well. But then on the fourth level, it's about integration of standards and methods and being efficient with our workflow. We start to have metrics in place which allow us to check and understand the performance across a company.
Which brings us to the final phase, having a continuous improvement cycle. And that's when you have sustained performance, where you evaluate your performance based on your past performance so you can influence your future decisions. And that's really what we're aiming for. That's the goal. Not just following normal ad hoc non-formal standards and being able to really put something in place that can be continuously improved. What are we planning for, Ezzy?
Good question. you can use BIM for a variety of tasks, but to really align these tasks, we want to eliminate some of the risk. So it's important to identify what the risks on the projects are. For example, if we're using BIM for a complex design of a building, we might want to use coordination to minimize the risk of failure. And coordination is actually one of the most common reasons for using BIM. You might also want better quantities. So you want to get more accurate costings to avoid overspending.
And for facilities too, right? I mean, that requires a lot of asset information. And that's a BIM use as well. So aligning the expectations and aligning what those uses are right from the very beginning can help you with what comes next in creating this BIM execution plan. And that helps to eliminate risk. So how do we find these uses? So here's some examples of models that could be associated with those uses. And they allow teams to eliminate a lot of that risk.
Sure. I mean, these are pretty typical examples of a project lifecycle, starting with the design through to construction, coordination, all the way through to facilities. And we've got to figure out where we are in the process. And sometimes you might be coming in halfway through the design process or just getting into the construction phase. So align those expectations with a client or team member right away, and you'll definitely start on the right foot. Some might say, well, let's use BIM for everything. And that's not always the best strategy. Often a targeted approach is better.
Here's an example of what an owner might ask for if they're not so well informed. So here the request is LOD4 plus COBE, and that's completely undefined, you know, so that makes it really difficult to deliver. And I'm sure you guys have all seen something like this before, where there's three kinds of service. There is good, fast, and cheap, but you can only pick two of them. So if you want good and cheap, it won't be fast. If you want fast and good, it won't be cheap. And you can have cheap and fast, but it won't be good.
Yeah, so we've established that we need to have a BIM execution plan to align the expectations. So now let's go through what needs to be included in the plan. Here are some typical categories of what we might include. Let's start with an introduction, include our project information, the BIM uses, the processes we want to follow, the standards we want to adhere to, the relevant technology, the deliverables, contract terms, and scope. So let's take a closer look at some of these.
So Typical BIM execution plan will have anything from project information, the contact team list, or even links to other web applications, you know, share where all of the other files or models are stored. So we mentioned introductions, but they could be different for each and every project. So some projects might need a robust mission statement and a definition of why you're even adopting BIM, while others might be slightly further along, and they might be more training-related introductions. And then you might also have sometimes a need for more detail into the process and understanding of how things will be delivered.
And then we need to define what the BIM uses are. What's the value that we're trying to achieve with a 4D BIM schedule? Why are we doing that? You know, why are we cost estimating? Why are we getting these quantities?
So identify the customer and the reasons why they're about to do it. So aligning that with the client will align those expectations on those BIM uses right away. And then what processes do we need in order to achieve those BIM uses? And is there a flow diagram that requires a step-by-step explanation about how you're going to run a coordination workflow, for example?
And then we look at standards. Are you following the standards like 19650? Are you looking to define the same terminology so that everyone is always on the same page? We highly recommend that you do. What is an asset information model, for example, and how is it driven? What are the connections? How do you go through scoping that and finding out what informs it? And who are the parties involved and why?
So believe me, the standardizing your models helps so much because you're combining them into one platform for coordination. So the naming of the equipment, the piping, all the way down to the naming of the files is extremely helpful. So standardize your models and keep everyone on the same page so you know where to find things. And then on the technology side, how are you going to support that? Are you going to have interactive workspaces? Are you going to recommend certain types of hardware, like computers or tablets or whatever, and software versions as well? And so all this is kind of a bit more of a recommendation to align than a mandate, depending on how you're going to work.
And then we'll look at the deliverables. How do you define your information requirements and your handover? And essentially, the format that you're looking for. We recommend open BIM standards and IFC as a file transfer. There are other requirements that people put into contracts, relevant information that's specific to the project. So for example, on the right-hand side there, we're adding in a signature block so we can actually get people's contractual buy-in. And we'll talk more about buy-ins later.
So onto probably the most important part of a BIM execution plan, the scope. You want to align what scope is required, who's responsible, how much information is needed, and again, why are we doing BIM? What are those BIM uses? Aligning a scope can really help everyone.
Yeah, now that we've covered why we need a BIM execution plan, and we've covered what needs to be included, we can now focus on how you can get your team engaged. How do you get your team to start actively being part of that process?
What we have here is a pretty common workflow. You know, you create a file, probably a PDF, email that to a team and try to collect feedback. And there's a lot of challenges in that workflow. It usually leads to large documents. It's a time-consuming process, you know, waiting for feedback. And then sometimes some teams, they're just not adopting it at all and ended up even more confused.
Yeah. So, you know, when you ask what happens to the BEP, it's like, hey, did you get that file I sent by email, Damien?
What email? What are you talking about?
Yeah, you know, it's really easy to ignore something that's sent by email. And even if people admit that they did see it, they might tell you, oh, I didn't read it, or I didn't understand it, or it was just too long to read. You know, there are a lot of excuses. So how do we engage people? How do we engage the team to actually look at it and understand the useful information that's in there? How do we engage the team?
Well, so here's a few tips. If you create a central hub, a central place for project information, contact details, and how to get access to files that everyone needs for the project. But rather than storing a set of links and everything in a lot of different places, keep that all in one place. And that makes it easy for teams to find contact details, for example. And then you can let them keep their contact details up to date rather than you having to spend your precious time managing that.
How about making it simple? Encapsulate a workflow in a diagram so we can visualize those standards and processes, making it a lot more attractive for people to get into.
Create it together. If you create something together, it feels less mandated and helps everyone feel more included.
Yeah, and also using video content. It's so much better than 5 pages of text that people just aren't going to read. And it obviously saves paper as well. We see a lot of successful teams creating 1 or 2 minute how-to videos, how to model something in Revit, how to coordinate something, or how to use a clash detection in Navisworks. You know, and 1 or 2 minute videos, so much better than having pages and pages of instructions.
Yeah, and then people actually watch it, you know, so that's kind of the goal. And it's not just videos, you know, you can use rich content like embedded flowcharts that makes it interactive, because you can embed live files. You can actually have interactive model walkthroughs as well. Like in this example here from a Matterport as-built walkthrough directly in BIM Execution Plan. So rather than sending it by email, just put it in your BEP and people will actually start engaging with it and actually looking at it and reading it.
So we've talked about why we need a BIM execution plan, what to include in it, and how to get people engaged in it. But even if we have the right content, how do we get people to sign off on it? How do we get the agreement?
So some of the challenges that we see in getting that agreement is that these documents usually start out being created in an isolated way. It's difficult to get that buy-in because it's a single file in a single place managed by a single person. And then there's feedback. Once the document's been created, it gets sent to like 10 different people. You have to wait to get the feedback, gather that feedback, update the content. And because it's a large document, because there's so much there, it takes time. And that creates a bottleneck, either when the feedback is received or when it gets shared again.
Yeah, so those are some of our other challenges. And the best results come from breaking it down into bite-sized releases of information, taking a section of a document and publishing it or sharing it, allowing a viewer to only see that one section, and you can control the amount that you want them to see. Then they can review the workflow of a document and be able to leave their thoughts and comments, comments which relate precisely to that section, rather than trying to review and comment on the whole document.
Yeah, and then it becomes like leaving a comment on Facebook. You know, you can just leave a sentence or two and you get notified, and then, you know, right away what the feedback is, and updates can be done in minutes rather than days.
Sure, totally. And to get agreement, we can't just have a live document because there's a fear that it's always going to be changing. But there are certain aspects that develop over time, which means that there are times that we can benefit from having a live document. But also being able to archive it as a PDF and then share it, the link with others, this is a really important part of the workflow.
We've talked about why, what to include, how to include your team, how to get agreement from everyone on the team. So now let's talk about how to continuously improve it.
Well, we can just copy it from the last project, yeah?
I don't think that's a good idea, Izzy. No.
But it's the fastest way. Come on, it'd be fine.
Yeah, so sometimes it does seem that way. But what it actually does, and this is just a few challenges that, that you might face, copying and pasting can carry unrealistic expectations from one project to another. So potentially, if you're copying and pasting, it might cause a lot of problems down the line if it's not selective and if it isn't done in a controlled way.
And if you just copy everything over from the previous project, you're then going to have to go through everything and decide what's relevant and what isn't. And that's a whole lot of work.
And so that's just a few of the challenges. But the implication of those challenges is that it's not lean. We talked about implementing bite-sized workflows. But those unlean workflows, they create bottlenecks. They create misunderstandings. And that creates confusion and blame and finger-pointing. And there's a lot of liability and a lot of risk in those types of workflows.
Yeah, so here's a few tips. Figure out what is the general information that you use from project to project. What's consistent on every project? If you make those templates, you'll save time at the start of each plan. And then you can focus on adding only the project-specific information.
And involve your team. You know, if someone on your team isn't happy with something, listen. You know, what would make their workflow more efficient? Don't just mandate a certain workflow because you read about it somewhere. Figure out what works for you.
Gather all of that information together.
Template for each project type or each region or both. You know, managing those templates and getting buy-in from everyone. But keep them all in a single place so they can be continuously improved and updated easily.
And finally, you create your competitive advantage. You reach level 5. Sustain performance for the future by evaluating your past performance and learning the lessons to help you achieve success. If we achieve success by implementing a BEP, it really is an awesome tool, and we end up with an awesome result.
Yeah, that's great. That's what we want. So in conclusion, so we've just shared a few insights on how to improve your BIM execution planning. So the first one was understanding why you're doing BIM in the first place. Really understanding what the BIM uses are, and that'll help you tie everything together. Then everyone's aware of why they're modeling to a certain level of geometry or why they're adding that information, whatever it is. So there's fewer questions and it becomes a lot more efficient.
And again, you know, create your templates so you can save time when you start a new project. Remember, it's easier than having to update your new project with a template rather than copying and pasting. Also, adding in that rich content, those flowcharts, those videos, making it easier to engage people and get their buy-in. And also, making sure your templates are always accessible and easy to update so your team can keep feeding back and continually improving.
Yep, so don't forget, this is the second in the series of 10 webinars. We're doing them every fortnight, so please don't forget to sign up to the future ones. And also, we're announcing a free giveaway of a BIM readiness check. This is usually worth £300, but everyone who joined us today is entitled to that.